We are going to have a lively discussion this evening around the title Training Crystal City by Jan Jarboe Russell, so thank you all for being here. It has been my pleasure to work with Dr. Dupuy and Paula Owen from the Southwest School of Art. Thank you both so much for the partnership that we have between the library and the Southwest School. I think it has enriched the library immeasurably. If you guys have not visited the Marie Swartz Art Resource Center on the second floor of the library, please do. This is one result of the partnership between the Southwest School of Art and the library. The Marie Swartz Art Resource Center serves as the library for the Southwest School of Art, but it's also just an incredibly beautiful space and an incredibly amazing collection that is also open to the public. So I want to thank the Library Foundation, especially for funding this program and for enriching partnership through these opportunities that we have for discussion together. I want to thank the Southwest School for organizing the program. And before we get started, I want to welcome Dr. Eddie Dupuy, the Dean of the Southwest School.
Thanks very much, Dee Dee. It's a real pleasure to see everybody here and to welcome you to this first panel discussion on otherness. As Dee Dee said, I'm Dr. Eddie Dupuy. I'm the Dean of the Southwest School of Art. You may know that after 50 years of offering programming for youth, teens, and adults, the Southwest School of Art began a college program last fall. It was a natural next step in our development in teaching and advancing the liberal arts. The visual arts, I should say. And we're in our second year of the program. We have some of our students here, most of them in the second year, and we have 36 students, and many of our faculty are here tonight as well, so I'm delighted to see them. I think we have some Trinity students with us as well. So the panel discussion tonight is part of our One Book program at the school. We selected Jan Jarboe Russell's book both because of its timeliness and timelessness. The issue of how we acknowledge and treat the other is as old as the biblical story of the exile of the Israelites into Babylon and as fresh as the border and immigration issues in our own Texan backyard. Jan Jarboe Russell's A Train to Crystal City brings to light the dark and very complex history of World War II, internment camps in Crystal City, Texas, a mere few hours' drive from where we are right now. We're fortunate to have a distinguished group of panelists tonight, and I'm delighted to be able to introduce them all to you. First, of course, is Jan herself. Jan Jarboe Russell is a former columnist at the San Antonio Express News and currently contributing editor to Texas Monthly. In her long career in journalism, she's covered Texas politics and culture with an emphasis on San Antonio. She's the author of Lady Bird, a biography of Mrs. Johnson, published by Scribner's in 1999, and of course, the critically acclaimed The Train to Crystal City, published by Scribner's in 2015. She lives with her husband here in San Antonio. Lauren Turek is assistant professor of history at Trinity University, where she teaches classes on modern American history and the history of U.S. foreign relations. She earned a PhD in history from the University of Virginia and is currently working on a book about religion and U.S. foreign policy. Jason Johnson is assistant professor of modern European history at Trinity University. He received a PhD in modern European history with a specialization in German history from Northwestern University. Dr. Johnson has held a Fulbright Fellowship to Germany, and the Northwestern History Department awarded his dissertation the annual Harold Perkin Award for Best Dissertation in History. At Trinity, he teaches a variety of courses on modern European history, including the history of World War II and the history of the Holocaust. David Martin Davies is a familiar voice, if not a familiar face. He's a veteran journalist with over 25 years' experience covering Texas, the border, and Mexico. Davies is the host of The Source, a live call-in news program that airs on KSTX at 3 p.m. Monday through Thursday. Since 1999, he has been the host and producer of Texas Matters, a weekly radio news magazine that looks at the issues, events, and people in the Lone Star State. Davies' reporting has been featured on National Public Radio, American Public Media's Marketplace, and the BBC. He has written for San Antonio Light, the San Antonio Express News, the Texas Observer, and many others, and he's also garnered several awards for his journalistic activity. He'll be our moderator this evening. So Jan Jarboe Russell will start us off with a short reading from her book, and then the discussion will begin. Thank you all again for coming very much.
Many thank yous that I'm not going to drag it out, but I know I wanted to thank the library and, of course, the Southwest School. I've so enjoyed my interaction with some of the students in the school around my book. I do believe in two things, words and image, and I always love to be around artists because they constantly remind me about the image, and I really appreciate this opportunity. I will make a short reading, but before I wanted to kind of square out how my book, of The Train to Crystal City, fits into our panel's discussion of otherness. We're really honored to have this discussion and with these group of people. And what happens in war, especially great wars such as World War I and World War II, is that it's a natural instinct for patriotism that can, in fact, result in scapegoating of people who are immigrants, even legal immigrants, and that's what happened to my characters in The Train to Crystal City. I just want to give you a little brief context for the book. Franklin Roosevelt has a reputation as a kind of congenial president, always doing good things. But when it came to the internment of Japanese Americans, Germans, and German Americans, Italians, and Italian Americans, it could be argued that Roosevelt was congenially ruthless. In the run-up to World War II, FDR's focus shifted dramatically from conditions at home, the much-loved New Deal, to the events abroad. He realized that America would eventually have to get into the war, but in the 1930s, isolationism gripped the nation. Even after Hitler invaded Poland on September 1st, 1939, polls showed that 90% of Americans favored neutrality. The country was not yet ready for war. In response to that event, the invasion of Poland, Roosevelt created a secret division within the Department of State called the Special War Problems Division. And the job of the Special War Problems Division was to identify American civilians who were living in Europe and the Far East and would be in danger in the event of war. These civilians were diplomats, businessmen, missionaries, journalists, and these were the people that Roosevelt knew to be in harm's way the moment that we got into the war. In addition, in 1939, he asked the State Department to prepare a plan to internment camps civilians of foreign descent, particularly German and Japanese, who were living legally in the United States. So these were not illegal immigrants, they were legal immigrants from Japan and Japanese. Even before this, 3 years before this, on October 24, 1936, Roosevelt had given J. Edgar Hoover, director of the FBI, broad powers to investigate Japanese, German, and Italian immigrants who either because of their occupations or their activities were suspected of could be disloyalty to the United States. After the attack on Pearl Harbor on December 7, 1941, the entire political and military establishment applied pressure on Roosevelt to act immediately against Japanese immigrants. They immediately became the other, even if they had nothing to do with the bombing of Pearl Harbor. But also German and Italians who were immigrants from Axis countries. Most of us know about Executive Order 9066, which forced the removal of 120,000 Japanese, two-thirds of them American-born, from the West Coast. So just because these people had were Japanese in their blood, they were taken to these war relocation centers and held there. But under the terms of this same order, 9066, Germans and Italians were also subject to internment as well. Meanwhile, Hoover had, since 1936, been compiling these lists of suspect enemy aliens, and those were the most other of the others. And within 48 hours after the attack on Pearl Harbor, 1,200 Japanese leaders, merchants, farmers, priests, newspapermen were arrested without charges. 602 Germans and 98 Italian were also arrested. The term enemy alien meant that the people that were enemy aliens were indefinitely held in internment, and they had no access to lawyers, no legal way to petition the government. As you know, my book focuses on this largely unknown camp, the Crystal City internment camp, which became the center of Roosevelt's enemy alien program. So people that Hoover had been investigating since 1936, that the camp existed for two purposes. One was to reunite enemy alien fathers with their wholly innocent wives, and to a great extent, American-born children in Crystal City. The other was the fact that Crystal City became the center of Roosevelt's prisoner exchange program. We don't realize it, but because of the Enemy Alien Act of 1798, because of that act, you could be arrested if you were a citizen of a country we were at war with. So it wasn't personal to the government, even though it was very personal to the people who were arrested. And so the people in the Crystal City internment camps, it was the only camp that had multiple nationalities: German, Italian, and Japanese, as well as the fact that Hoover had also orchestrated the kidnapping of about 4,000 people from 13 different countries in Latin America for the purpose of exchange. Those two were there too. So over the course of the war, the camp in Crystal City, as Eddie said, 120 miles from where we sit tonight, was commonly known as the kidnap camp. We were kidnapping people and bringing them to Crystal City, and then sending many of them out in six different prisoner exchanges. As a journalist, you know, to find this kind of an activity going on in your own backyard that is, for the most part, incredibly secret is a rare and compelling situation. So over the course of 5 years, I worked to get the records of the camp declassified, the FBI files of the fathers declassified, and interviewing children that were in the camp. We're going to talk about that. But the great tragedy of the Crystal City camp, no matter what you think about what FDR did, is that so many American-born children, Japanese and German, were traded into war in these exchanges for people that were ostensibly more important Americans. And it was quite shocking for the children to learn that themselves, because they did not know of their role in the war. And quite shocking to me. I'm going to read from one, as in war, things go awry in the fog of war, and things are supposed to behave, go one way, and they often go the wrong way. Since we're talking about otherness tonight, I wanted to describe the last one scene from the last prisoner exchange in 1945. In January of 1945, when one of my main characters, Ingrid Iserl, a German American from Cleveland, and her family were traded, and the surprise of the thing was that since this was the last trade of the war, we had very few Americans left in Germany. Almost all of them had come back. There were in that trade a few American POWs who did get out in the 45 trade. But because there weren't very many Americans, we ended up trying to save 350 Jews who were at the Bergen-Belsen concentration camp. So in the trade that was supposed to be American for Germans, Ingrid Iserl was traded for a German Jew in Bergen-Belsen, which is just tells you that things don't always work out as you expected. And I'd like to read from a passage that I've never read publicly before because it's very emotional for me. Irene Hassenberg's father, when she was born in Germany, but her father was a banker in Amsterdam. She was a close friend of Anne Frank's. In fact, right before this passage begins, one of her last acts in Bergen-Belsen was to give Anne Frank, who was still alive at that time, Irene took her last piece of bread to Anne Frank before she got on the train out. So that was pretty astonishing. The conditions, we had about 5,000 people at the time that they looked at this in Crystal City at the time of this exchange. There were 15,000 Jews still alive in Bergen-Belsen. So, of course, the conditions of the camp couldn't be compared because our camp was a humanitarily run camp. Their camp was run by Joseph Kramer, who was known as the butcher of Bergen-Belsen. So let me read from this. And this is the kind of thing, there's no black and white answers in my book. When you hear that Ingrid was traded for Irene, you have to ask, well, was it worth it for us to do all of this? And I think that's the thing I like about the book the most, is that there's no easy answers to this. This is, she describes, at night, this is Irene describing, at night in the barracks, the women would lie in the dark and describe recipes for their favorite food. That's because they were all starving. Stuffed beasts, breast of veal, goulash, vegetables of all kind, cakes and cookies. Each woman would try to outdo the others in these nighttime fantasy feasts. During these nights, Irene thought to herself that there was no word to describe the physical pain of hunger. Quote, true hunger is a painful, ever-present feeling that it's impossible to comprehend, Irene said. It's gnawing. It's hollow. During the day, Irene cleaned the barracks and did the laundry. There was no soap, only cold water. When mothers left the barracks to go to work, Irene and the other young teenagers cared for the smaller children. Her brother, Werner, did hard labor alongside his father. Under conditions that were barely survivable, Irene and her family spent 11 months in Bergen-Belsen. Every night I went to sleep hoping that I would wake up in the morning, Irene recalled. Finally, on January 21, 1945, after the Hassenberg families had passed some examinations by the Nazis, they assembled at the center of the camp with a group of about 300 other Jews in Bergen-Belsen who were on the list for exchange. Near evening, a train flying a Red Cross flag rolled into the camp. Irene and Werner steadied their mother, Gertrude, as they walked up the steps into the heated train, her father, John, following behind. Both parents were suffering from starvation. As the train moved slowly out of Bergen-Belsen's, the Hassenbergs were silent. The train headed for Switzerland was forced to make numerous stops. Allied pilots had bombed many of the tracks and they had to be cleared. At times, the train sat on the tracks for hours, unable to move. In the compartment, both Gertrude and John were in great physical pain. They struggled to stay upright in their seats. Werner and Irene, both also suffering from malnutrition, did their best to take care of their parents. On the second night of the four-day journey, John got up to go to the bathroom. He was too weak to walk by himself, so Irene took his hand and walked and led him. "We're almost free now," she witnessed. "I'm not going to make it," he replied. That night, John fell asleep on Irene's shoulder, and during the night, he died. Irene shook him, but there was no response. For several hours, she and Werner held him in their arms and wept. Gertrude seemed confused, unable to comprehend what had happened. John was the first person to die on the train. 150 more died before they got to the exchange. Over the next few days, in the morning, a nurse came by and declared John dead. His body was wrapped in a blanket and thrown off the train at the next town on a bench near the train station. The indignity of it, their father left in a strange town with no funeral rites, did not yet penetrate Irene or Werner. After all they had endured, they were too numb. They were in shock. So we know about the Jews have representing the other, which is what our discussion is. But as difficult as it is to say, the kids in Crystal City who were Japanese American and Italian American and German American were also the other. So shall we talk about that?
Well, I just really can't say enough about what an achievement this book is, a journalistic achievement, investigative reporting achievement. Janet was able to go where a lot of reporters, where other reporters have not been able to go, for this doggedness and ingenuity and also her humane approach to this incredible story. And she answered a very important question that, I mean, I've gone to Crystal City and I've interviewed people who were in Crystal City before and told that story, but to go and tell the deeper story about why this happened, you know. And so she tells the story that this was a political decision. We've all heard the story about, you know, the United States was in hysteria and people were worried about the Japanese and we made a mistake. We opened these camps and we did this and we apologized for it and we learned a lesson. But she tells a story that this is a political decision done for specific reasons and a part of a strategy, and makes you really believe that this was not an isolated incident, and things like this will happen. It's not a one-off in American history. Things like this will happen, and so, you know, the full title of the event tonight is "Otherness: A Panel Discussion on Immigration, Internment, Detainment, and the Plight of Others in America." So who are others? Who are the others in America? And I believe that others is, who is the other, is a fluid condition. Who's a other today or not an other today could be one or not tomorrow. It all depends upon a political expediency. We experience that now, today, as we're going through a very coarse political process with these primaries, and we're hearing people calling for mass deportations. Also, we have that going on today, not far from us, in Dilley and Karnes City, where we have detainment centers for people who are fleeing basically failed governments in Central America, and they have already come through horrible conditions, and they find conditions that are pretty terrible in here in the United States. You look back in our own history in Texas, you don't have to go back very far. I've been reading a lot about women's suffrage here in Texas, and you know, the women didn't have the vote in Texas until 1918. That was just for primaries. That was a year earlier than the United States as a whole, but still it was, you know, astonishing. Women could not serve on juries in Texas until 1954. Why is that? What is the otherness? So otherness could be a gender. Could be a gender identity. We see that already. Conditional whiteness. What does that mean? Well, whiteness that is given can be taken away if you don't have the right attitudes, if you don't have the right thought process, because otherness can be an affiliation. The Red Scare, communism, mm-hmm. here. The San Antonio Public Library, where we are today during the Red Scare, was raided by the Bexar County Sheriff's Department as they seized the library records trying to see who checked out what books. Could that happen today? Well, just last week, mm-hmm. we saw Planned Parenthood raided and the seizing of records. Records that are supposed to be confidential between women and their doctors. Mm-hmm. Women who sought treatment at these places, who were guaranteed that their identities would be protected, have now been seized. What will happen with that information? We don't know. What is otherness? Who are the others? So we're going to be talking about that. So, you know, and aside, I mean, just this weekend I was here at the in the library on the sixth floor in the Texana department, going through old newspapers, 1968 newspapers, looking at doing some research, and I came across, here's a story about in 1968, January, they were had a seminar for the 70s, Mayor McAllister and other great establishment individuals in San Antonio held a conference for the weekend where they were going to figure out what San Antonio was going to do in the 1970s. And their big issues, their big ideas were, well, let's figure out a way to honor the heroes of the Alamo with Alamo Plaza. Let's get rid of all those businesses out there in front of Alamo Plaza. Let's find another water resource for San Antonio. We need more water here. Let's build a river walk all the way to Brackenridge Park, you know. And I was astonished about all of the things that they were talking about in 68. We're still talking about it today. And so there is this concept of contemporariness. We are locked into the day that we live, and it's hard for us to gain perspective about what does it mean to live in this age. And looking back, you can see that history does repeat itself. Hopefully we will learn the lessons of the train, the Crystal City, and some of these other, but I don't know. Well, let's get going here. Let's, we got two more scholars to hear from, people who know what they're talking about. So, not me, because I don't. Jason Johnson, you know, let's talk about European history.
Sure. Well, thank you for organizing this panel, TBR, Southwest School of Art, Jan, for this fabulous book, in this beautiful space to this beautiful library. I'm going to begin on the other side of the planet, mm-hmm. As it were, to talk a little bit, briefly, just about how Crystal City even came about. That is, where did this war come from? That is, how did Adolf Hitler come to power? And where does otherness play in there? Adolf Hitler, as you might know, was appointed Chancellor of Germany, January 30th, 1933. He did not seize power. There was no Nazi seizure of power. That's a myth they made up. He was handed power. The majority of Germans never voted for the Nazis. He knew he had a lot of work ahead of him. Turned out, about a month after his appointment, at the end of February 1933, it was a really cold Berlin night, the Reichstag the Parliament building caught on fire. We don't know for sure what happened, but the building was gutted. And Hitler saw this, of course. And he penned it on a young Dutch communist. And the Nazis have been talking all along about the dangers of communism and how Jews control communism. And these two movements in particular are out to destroy Germany. And Hitler started saying after this Reichstag fire, look at this other out there trying to destroy us all. Germany is under attack. It's us versus them. He used fear of this other to get total control of German society. About a month later, March, he goes back to this parliament and he says, will you, German parliament, give me unlimited dictatorial power for 4 years? Our nation is under attack. There's this other out to get us. They've burnt down our Capitol building, more or less. And 83% of the German parliament says absolutely. And that's it. He has total unlimited power. Shortly thereafter, he sets up a concentration camp in a beautiful little town, it's a suburb of Munich called Dachau. He starts putting his enemies, the communists especially, first. Then by 1935, he's able to pass because of this power given to him out of this fear-mongering of the other that the Nazis have created and the wake of this fire. 1935, there's Nuremberg laws that make it, that make being a German citizen and a Jew impossible. Jews become subject of the German Reich. But this all goes back to this fire and this fear-mongering and saying our nation is under attack, we have these enemies inside the country, we have to do something. And it's this fear, the power of this fear, I think, that is present often in this story and all around us.
Wow.
And you think perhaps it can't happen in the United States where we don't have a dictator in power. And yet, what we end up seeing after the attack on Pearl Harbor, again, an attack on the American nation, there are people out there out to get us. What we see is a tremendous amount of fear-mongering and scapegoating occurring in the United States. So one of the most incredible parts of this incredible book that Jan has written is the section where she describes sue me and Ingrid, two American-born, American citizens, teenagers, who are repatriated to Germany and to Japan, countries that they were not born in, that these are the countries of their parents' origin, places that they perhaps never set foot in. And so this repatriation process raises some real questions about American constitutional rights and civil liberties in wartime. How could this repatriation of American citizens to another country have possibly been considered legal or acceptable? And this, for me, is where this question of otherness really comes into play. During World War II, Japanese Americans and German Americans were singled out for official persecution because American leaders and the public viewed them as others by virtue of their identification with America's enemies in war, Japan and Germany. After Pearl Harbor, decades of anti-Asian sentiments in the US, especially in the West, erupted. These are sentiments that were longstanding, and it's evidenced by the fact that back in 1924, the US passed immigration restrictions that prevented Japanese immigrants from coming to the US. Now, by the time of Pearl Harbor, many of FDR's advisors and FDR himself see Japanese Americans as fundamentally different from other Americans, no matter how long they've lived here. One of his generals, Lieutenant General John DeWitt, called for the Japanese evacuation from the West, and he actually said, and I quote, "The Japanese race is an enemy race, and while many second and third generation Japanese born on United States soil, possessed of United States citizen, have become Americanized, the racial strains are undiluted." So after Pearl Harbor, FDR issues several presidential proclamations which authorize the United States States to detain any allegedly dangerous alien enemies, and most of his advisors supported this. The FBI began rounding up and arresting thousands of people of German, Italian, and Japanese origin on the suspicion that they might be enemy aliens who posed a threat to American security during wartime simply because of their ethnic origins, their otherness. Now, a minority of those people may have held pro-Axis views, but the vast majority of those who were arrested posed no threat at all. They were offered no chance to defend themselves against accusations that they were committing espionage or anything else, which is something that Jan shows very clearly in the book. Now, we all know about the Executive Order 9066 that actually starts off the process of these internment camps, the forced incarceration of Japanese and German citizens. The question then is, how is this justified legally? One of the Japanese citizens, or Japanese Americans, who is incarcerated is Fred Korematsu, a resident of California, and he challenged the internment all the way up to the Supreme Court. And the Supreme Court ruled 6-3 that FDR's internment of Japanese Americans was completely legal. It was completely constitutional. How can this be? It's because the threat of potential espionage during wartime outweighed the individual rights of Korematsu and others of Japanese ancestry. And laws such as the Alien Enemy Act of 1798 and the Sedition Act, acts which remain in effect today, allow the government to detain enemy aliens upon declaration of war. So national security concerns in the U.S. intersect in really important ways with otherness and lead to the denial of what we would consider to be very basic civil and constitutional rights owed to all Americans. So it can happen here.
So, Jan, you know, you chronicle this event in post-World War II, and as the war breaks out in the United States, I mean, was that the attitude of the common person? What did they know what was happening into this regard in across the United States, and did they figure that this was just the way to do things?
Well, from what I can speak from Texas' point of view, you know, the everyone was behind Roosevelt in the war, the vast majority of them. And so the newspapers, including the San Antonio newspapers, published things: if you see anything suspicious, turn these people in, which is the kind of thing we hear today, right? If somebody picks up your bag at the airport, you call the police, right? And so there was this attitude that the country had to win the war, and that Roosevelt said, I'm going to prosecute the war at all costs. And everybody got the vast majority of Americans went along with that. And even Eleanor Roosevelt, who had definitely worked hard to not let this happen, the internment, ultimately she too went along with it. So I think that's the case. If I could just comment a little bit on these two incredibly important points that they have made. You know, one of the things that I learned in talking to the children of the camp, both German Americans and Japanese Americans, the issue of loyalty became hugely important to them in their family barracks in the camp, because the American-born children, perhaps as a response to the fact they didn't see themselves as other before the war broke out, because in Los Angeles there were a lot of Japanese Americans in schools, and there was a multicultural. Sumi went to school with people from the Philippines, from you know, black people, green people, every kind of person was, you know, in her high school. By the same token, Ingrid had grown up in a German-American community where Beethoven was played and songs were done. And the moment the war started, all of that stopped. You know, hamburgers became Salisbury steak and stuff like that, on even the level of life. So there was this overreaction on the part of the children of the camp to be uber American. Uber, to be, you know, to keep trying to prove their patriotism, which is one reason that they went back to the countries of their parents to prove to people that, you know, they all joined the American military when we had an occupying force. So I now see that too, as David was talking about. We all see Latino kids who are uber American, you know. We've got the dreamers and we've got the people joining the military, and that it's a reaction of thinking you can earn yourself into, you could get your citizenship back if you're just American enough. I think that's one thing. And as he was saying about what was happening in Germany, it's interesting to me that Biddle, who was our attorney general and who was against this too, in the Nuremberg trial, he was one of the people in the trial. And he, who had signed all these certificates for all these kids in Crystal City, American as well as not, he gets confronted when the German lawyers say, but you too had concentration camps. And so the idea that we're so different, that, I mean, we were different in levels of extremes, our internment, but at least in Germany at the time, they got blowback, and Biddle had to say, to express his regret for this very thing. And so I think one of the things is, one of the reasons you have scapegoats is to build up your position, right? It's, if you're the president and you can scapegoat somebody, you're building up your position. We're pure, you're not pure. And so I just think it's very, very tricky how we treat people in times of war. And now we're seeing this in San Antonio as well, with all these immigration issues and with the Muslims, you know, of being scapegoated. And I think a lot of the problem is exactly what she said, is that we have these old rules of, especially the Enemy Alien Act of 1798. I knew she'd get it right. I didn't know if it was 88 or 98. Anyway, until we get rid of that, we're not going to make much progress, you see. And there's no political power for it, because it's so much easier for a politician to demonize another than to take responsibility for their own job.
Just to add on a little bit there, bringing the German perspective, as you were mentioning, after the war, American journalists, American soldiers would ask average Germans, how could this have happened, this being the Holocaust? They almost always said two things. One, they said, "Nicht gegen zu machen." There's nothing that I could have done about it. And then they pointed to this. They said, "You had concentration camps in your country too." Mm-hmm. And the good people of San Antonio or Charlotte or wherever were out marching in the streets against that. So how can you blame us? That's what they said. Yeah.
Well, Jason, let me ask you about Hitler's rise. Yeah. When he was chancellor and he was building up Germany, it's my understanding that he was speaking about peace, that he wanted, he was a peace candidate.
Right.
Can you talk about that?
Mm-hmm. Right.
His
so
rhetoric.
There's a promise of stability that Hitler offers. The aftermath, as you probably know, of World War I is so intense. In Germany, the country is largely destroyed. It is blamed for the war. It gets a bill in today's dollars that's about $800 billion that has to be paid. And this is a country that has no functioning economy. There's this incredible hyperinflation that happens in 1923. Money becomes worthless. Literally, you get a paycheck, by the time you get to the bank to cash it, it is worthless. Hitler starts saying, "I promise stability, I promise German glory, I promise there will be no Bolshevik-style revolution."
And he says this insane stuff about Jews as well. He's creating this other. But it's these promises of stability that get him far for a while. By the end of the 1920s, though, he's not getting the kind of votes he wants. He starts backpedaling this anti-Semitic stuff. And he starts really focusing on promises of stability. And he gets 38-39% of the vote. But that's still not enough. The old power structure of Germany is a complicated system. Decides the best way to neutralize him as a threat is to appoint him chancellor, leader of the government, and they will make him go away. A very famous quote by one of these men who appointed him chancellor in 1933 was, "We'll appoint him a chancellor. Within a few months, he'll be back so far in the corner, he'll squeak like a mouse." And that was the plan. It's political infighting and promises of stability. But in this right foot, this fire happened, right? And he has a vision of Germany that he starts implementing. That is a racially pure Germany, pure of others, especially Jews, of course, because they are the archenemy in this worldview. But it's the promise of stability that really matters here. And by 1936, he can say that unemployment in Germany is null, it's zero. He's gotten jobs created for everyone through New Deal kind of programs, and that's what makes him. Stability, then jobs by the middle of the 1930s. And he starts taking, people start disappearing, but Jews are a small minority, they're a small other, and you have a job.
Mm-hmm. Lauren, you look at public policy, like American foreign policy, mm-hmm. and how does that come into play in defining the other?
So in situations like what we're talking about here with World War II, if you think about the countries that the U.S. sees as the enemy, because part of this panel is talking about immigration, too. Mm-hmm. So thinking about the United States as a country that has a large number of immigrants coming in, despite some of the immigration restrictions that I talked about, you have a country that during wartime there is the threat that immigrant populations are going to feel more loyal to the country of their birth. And this was a concern in World War I, and it was a concern again in World War II. And so when conflict breaks out, the fear is that you are not going to be as loyal to your own country, this United States where you've come to immigrate to, but you'll remain very loyal to the country of your birth. And so then it leads to questions about how do we rally the citizenry behind the war effort? Is there a threat that people are going to spy for their former country? Is there a threat that they may potentially engage in acts that will threaten U.S. national security? And so that's where this really comes into play. That's the fear, the threat that undergirds some of this, some of these decisions that FDR makes about interning enemy aliens and their families.
But you also understand from your bio that you look at Christian foreign policy lobbying mm-hmm. on the United States, looking at different regimes and how they treat Christians. And so in other parts of the world, the Christians are the others.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yes.
Absolutely. And so that is a fine example. So one of the one of the issues in World War II and what we're talking about is, is a Jewish lobby effective at getting FDR to engage in efforts to save the Jews in Germany? And the answer is no, he's not. But some of the groups that I look at are very effective later on in the 20th century in actually lobbying to protect the religious rights of themselves abroad, their ability to function as missionaries, but also to protect people who convert to Christianity in countries in the Middle East, in Eastern Europe, so that they are protected, and that shapes American foreign relations in significant ways. If your government is focused on protecting an other in another country,
Did you want to add to that, Jason? You looked like you did. Okay.
Yeah, go.
All right. It looks like you wanted to jump in, but we're almost out of time. But if there's anyone who's got a burning question, we're just an intimate group, and ask it. I'll rephrase it so we capture it, but. Just a quick question. Yes.
Yeah, I read the book and I was very impressed. I'd studied history and had some background, some knowledge. My father always said to always be careful because he knew of the camps, Neo-Mexican-Americans who were citizens who were deported in California because they were Mexican ethnic group, but they were born here. So quietly, just like a lot of Japanese people.
Sure, like in the Depression era, there was a lot of deportation Mexican labor, and it didn't matter if you were native-born or if you were not. Right. There was expulsions.
My question is actually for Mr. Turner.
Mm-hmm.
Sure. Yes, it's concerning the repatriation, which I really had a difficult time with that, and the exchange program that they established during this period, that they could arrest foreign-born nationals who were Japanese and other German and Italian, but especially the Japanese in South America, and put them in camps here in Crystal City. I don't understand that. How could their native country, like Ecuador or Venezuela, okay, how could these nations give up these people so easily? Mm-hmm. I don't understand that part of the
money. You can
money.
take
it out. Something that I don't understand. Is it like the embargoes? Well, we're not going to buy things from you?
So the question is, how do these countries in Central and South America give up their... People.
Well, I'm going to tell you how it worked in Crystal City. I don't know how it worked in other camps. But Roosevelt had a, quote, good neighbor policy going on in Latin America. And he was trying to establish some military installations in Latin America that would help protect the United States in the eventuality of the war. So he was dealing with 13 different countries said yes to him. Mexico said no and had its own internment camps inside Mexico. But the deal was that what the government got out of that is that in return for arresting these people and the government seized their properties. So if you had a big sake factory in Peru and you were the Donald Trump of sake at that time, then suddenly and this happened to Al Nishimoto in Crystal City, then what happened is that the FBI, working through the local police, rounded these people up, put them on an army boat and Peru and the port, and then they took them to the port of New Orleans, not New Braunfels. And the moment they stepped out on the American soil, they were arrested as illegal aliens. They were taken and doused, the kids talk about this, and put on the train to Crystal City. So they were stateless. They were stateless. Some of these people spoke only Spanish, were taken into Japan, into Germany, speaking Spanish. And so it was a crazy thing. Amazingly, 81 Jews who had fled the run-up to Hitler were in this group, 81 Jews from South America. One family, the Jacobi family from Colombia, was in Crystal City. So the story is that you can have a law, or then you can just kidnap people, and then but the legal basis for that is that they were in the United States illegally, having been kidnapped by the United States.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, I wanted to. I guess I'll address it to you. Netanyahu had a speech recently about how he equated what's going on with the Palestinians with how you had to get rid of, the Nazis and the Jews, like you had no choice but to go to war, and that was the end of that. And now he's equating that to what's going on with Palestine and saying basically we just have to get rid of them because there's no change. And so I feel like Netanyahu is really taking on this otherness and applying it political ways, and I just wanted to bring
that up. Right, and what about Netanyahu's claim that it was the Palestinians' idea to do the Holocaust?
And so this is why this has been in the news, right? Netanyahu has this claim that Hitler got the idea for the Holocaust, right, from that part of the world, and that is just factually not true, right? And so there is that problem that he's just saying information that is not accurate.
Yeah, but given his status, him just saying that, there are people that are willing to believe it. Truth is malleable in these circumstances.
Sure.
And so, and we see it all the time. You know, it becomes a mnemonic infection and it gets into people's brains, and next thing you know, now it's a fact.
Right. Absolutely. And it's this ability to use categories of otherness for political ends, right? And this is where the real danger comes in, and I think European history and American history, right? It's creating these categories in which certain people have more rights than others. That's what Hitler's doing across the 30s. That's what these Nuremberg laws are about, right? When rights are removed, when there's an imbalance in rights, that can be the first step to genocide, right? And that, for me, is where the danger really comes in, where there's inequality in rights that can lead to a really nasty ...
Right, but it seems like to what people are saying, how do we keep this from happening again? You know, I mean, it seems like in the past we've had individuals who can stand up, Albert Schweitzer or Albert Einstein or Nelson Mandela, people of great stature who can shout down these manipulators and demagogues and try and establish a moral compass again. And I don't know if we have that anymore.
Right. This is something I struggle with. I teach World War II, I teach the history of the Holocaust, right, at Trinity. And at the end of these courses, the students are saying, you know, what's the takeaway here, right? And there's this never again rhetoric, right? There have been, it's hard to define what a genocide is, but there have been probably at least 30 since people started saying that. The moral compass stuff, right, I think it gets to what we're all talking about. It's this fear of the other. I tell my students, don't be afraid, right, of people who are different from you, because it's that kind of thinking, right, that leads to Crystal City, leads to all the things that we're talking about here. And there's no silver lining to something like the Holocaust.
Irene, who was the Holocaust survivor here, you know, I start my book with her quote, and she says this at every speech, because she's doing peace talks with Palestinian women in her town, which is what we should be doing, Jews and Palestinians speaking, because she believes it's the stories that do the healing. She says enemies are people whose faces you've never seen and whose stories you've never heard. So some of the work of this is for other people to tell the stories now. It took 72 years for Ingrid to ever open her mouth about what happened to her. And it took Irene a long, long time to talk about what happened to her in Bergen-Belsen. I mean, I say, tell your stories, but that's an act of courage. It's not exactly, we can't all just hope that the politicians, like some fairy godmothers, are going to take care of us, because that's not true. I think we have to tell these stories again and again. And I'm very proud of the fact that there are journalists losing their lives right now trying to tell the story, and not just journalists. And so, not all politicians.
Yes, ma'am, I know you wanted to talk.
Two quick questions.
Okay.
In the 50s, when I was a child, every right-thinking, wealthy person had a Japanese gardener. They felt obligated to make some room for them back in society. And so I wonder, you know, 10 years before that, were there nobody in the elites of the country who were raising questions about what was done to the Japanese? Secondly, a far greater number of Japanese, both in absolute numbers and percentage-wise, in Hawaii.
Mm-hmm.
And while there were some spies rounded up, clearly the local population was not touched. Was the hysteria limited to the mainland?
Now, this is a matter of numbers. The same reason that, you know, that Roosevelt wanted to take every person with 1/16th blood of Japanese, he wanted every one of them taken. But in Hawaii, there were so many Japanese that the whole island would have collapsed in terms of work. And so they took the leaders. There were 250 Buddhist priests from Hawaii in Crystal City. That same thing happened to the Germans. Roosevelt, Biddles went to see Roosevelt one day, and he said, I want you to arrest every person of German background in this country, every single person of German background. He said, you know, the Italians, they're a bunch of opera singers, but these Germans, they're dangerous. That was the idea. The reason we didn't arrest every single German, I guess Texas would have gone to Louisiana by that point, because we had a lot of them here. Anyway, if we had done that, all the factories would have shut down. It was there were like so many Germans that we were depending upon. So it was a numerical question. No, he had some sort of some place in his lineage. Yeah, it was some place in his lineage. He had an ancestor who was a Dutch Jew, but it wasn't directly him. I mean, it was like, I don't know, three generations.
They're both from the same family.
Same family.
But you know, one thing about, you know, San Antonio, the sunken gardens we have.
Yes, exactly.
Breckenridge Park. You know, we had a family there. And they were
the Jingo family. Yeah.
The Jingo family, and they were basically like a zoo display of Japanese people that we had in San Antonio. That they would come out, their daughters would dress in the kimonos, and they would serve tea and do a tea ceremony for tourists and what have you. And then we had the war breakout, and the city basically had a huge outcry. I know where Japanese are. They're at the Sunken Gardens, and they drove those people out of town. And this family was very close to the Mavericks. They were not, you know, just like some incidental family. They had, and you know, the Mavericks, they were the congressmen at the time. Didn't matter. They were ran out of town.
And they renamed the garden the Chinese Garden. You remember?
Yeah. So that happened. Anyway, I know, ma'am, you had a question. I really want to get you in there.
Although, of course, it's going to be very hard to achieve, I wondered what the historians think about the protective power of economic strength. When there's lots of money and lots of jobs and lots of prosperity, do people not worry so much about those
That's
others?
A great question.
Well, I have enough, I'm not afraid, my job is secure, and we have plenty of jobs for them too. So I wondered, well, I just think the myth of American exceptionalism is so strong, people can tell their stories, but, you know, don't bother me with the facts.
Well, let me tell you what American exceptionalism means. American exceptionalism, we talk about all the great things America has done, except when we put people in camps, and except when we, you know, do all sorts of other things. But Jason, that question about economic power in a class, that is a sweet, fat, slow one right down your strike zone.
As I said, by 1936, on paper, there's zero unemployment in Germany, and that's what keeps the Nazis in power. And the first thing that Hitler does in 1933, he passes something because of this Enabling Act, he has all this power. He passes something called the Law for the Restoration of the German Civil Service, which seems harmless enough, right? The thing is, though, the law called for Jews to be banned for all parts of the German government employment, right? So teachers, for example, university professors were banned, lawyers were banned. And you would hope that non-Jewish Germans would stand up against this. But let's say that someone wanted the corner office in the law firm. Suddenly that's open. And that plays out at every level of German society from the very beginning. And so jobs matters, economic stability, at least from the 30s in Germany. It's the willingness to not stand up a
against such actions when there's quantity to be gained, job security and all of that, and there's very little to physically.
I think that's true in the United States. This is a great question. I think it's true in the United States too. If you look at a turn of the century factory work, when there is when we have low wages and a series of depressions in the United States, there is a lot of hostility that emerges to immigrant groups, even though they are often doing the sort of lowest paid work. And so what we see is in times of plenty, when there are plenty of jobs, that tends to decrease. And I think it's very similar to the case in Germany.
So. Can I get the last couple of questions? Yes, sir, back there. Can you stand up for us? A little bit louder.
My great uncle was a POW in Germany for about 8 or 9 months. So this really makes me think twice and all about how he's recovering and brought back. My question is, are any of you aware of any kind of evidence, documentation? Was there a systematic push in terms of covering this up as a subject? I mean, 65, 70 years later, and World War II is still such a very popular subject in books and movies on film. How has this never come up? I mean, I remember in California, Los Angeles, and Little Tokyo, there's memorials about the internment camps. I mean, we're in schools where we learn about Japanese Americans and what happens. How has this never, as a subject, been exposed?
So the question basically is, why is this not better well known? Why don't more people go out and buy copies of Train to Crystal City?
I don't know.
If you want to, there's a table back there with a twig that has some.
One of the reasons was that it was chosen for its isolated location. In other words, it was far from the East and West Coast. The Earl Harrison wrote, who was the Immigration and Naturalization Service, I got his diary, and he wrote in there that Crystal City is as close to Siberia as we have in the United States. And it was also close to the Latin American people that came that way, so they didn't have to go so far. The other issue is that when you went into this camp, when you left the camp, we didn't discuss kind of daily life in the camp, but daily life in the camp was highly regimented. There were censors on what people could write and what they did. And the penalty for trying to escape the camp was death. They had 6 guard towers around there, so it was a spooky place. But one of the reasons it didn't come out was because when you left the camp, even if you were a person who was old enough to write, you signed an oath saying you would never speak of your experiences in the camp. And most of these people grew up with, World War II is the feel-good movie in America, And so they weren't going to be walking around, especially the Germans, saying, I was an internee at the Crystal City internment camp. They were ashamed of what had happened to them. And they had signed this oath of secrecy, and they knew what the government could do. Ingrid was completely freaked out by the government. Whenever I went to interview her, I had to leave my cell phone in the car because she thought it was a personal tracking device. And so she had a healthy respect for the government. And so I think that's part of it. And this is not the greatest. This is like Kafka, you're reading in this stuff. It's not the most, it doesn't make you feel good. I'm very glad we won World War II. My father fought in World War II. His uncle was a POW in Germany. Perhaps he was part of the prisoner exchange. This is not easy. This is not an easy subject to discuss. And so a lot of it was because of the shame that the people felt about being interned.
All right, we really are out of time.
Thank you. Thank you.